That's a fun question. Do you remember the first album that you purchased with your own money that left a lasting impression on you?
I do. Yeah. My first album was an Incubus album, actually, and it was it was either Make Yourself or the one that came right after that with Nice to Know You and Party Music.
Morning View,
right. So it was either Morning View or Make Yourself, but I know I bought them both. Like, sort of the, I know, Party Me was on Make Yourself. I know, sorry. Fucking music nerd. Yeah, but it was, I may have bought them both at the same time, but I just remember like playing drums. I just wanted to sound like that guy, the drummer, Jose Pasillas the III. And so I bought those and tried to play along to them. Cool.
Yeah. Well, there were a few. I'm gonna have to say a few because there have been a few like crucial things in my life I gotta say. Because I took piano lessons for a little while in like second grade, and the first song I learned was like an Elvis song, and I was like, well, I want to hear the Elvis version. So I started like listening. I got like an Elvis cassette and started listening to all this Elvis. And then my brother got one of those Columbia House subscriptions. One of those Columbia House subscriptions. Yeah, it was like, you know, spend a penny and get like 15 CDs or cassettes or something. And I just got stuff that either looked cool or I'd like heard the name before. But in that I got all the three Guns N' Roses albums that they put out while they were like still playing together. And I remember, I really loved those. But Appetite for Destruction, I gotta say, was probably like really got me thinking about guitar and just like rock music and stuff like that. So, I mean, Slash was awesome. And then the first time I got a CD player, I got Off the Wall with it as well, Michael Jackson album. And that's what.
That's probably what Carson would say.
Yeah, that's awesome. What got
or
me.
Bass player.
Yeah. And then, yeah, me and my brother just were like blasting Michael Jackson all the time after that. Yeah.
Oh, God.
Off the Wall on CD.
And I was like James Brown, cold sweat.
1966.
Seriously.
James Brown, first Funkadelic album I remember well, of course. I was like 11. Oh, see, we had 8 tracks. I'm from a whole different era, but yeah.
First CD you bought, Joe.
First CD.
First MP3.
Like a couple weeks ago.
I say first MP3 you downloaded.
I only started buying CDs. I've only been buying CDs for about 10 years.
You know, and that's a shame. We have to say first MP3. That
right
now, because pretty soon the younger generation is not even going to know what a CD is.
Music
Late Bloomer band played came from vinyl. That's a fact.
Mm-hmm.
That's
true.
The vibe of that music came from vinyl. Hands down.
I would love when we do record, because that's clearly in our future, to lay it down to vinyl, because we've been playing still.
It's coming back.
Yeah,
it's
awesome.
People have been pressing vinyl.
We were just talking about that earlier today, actually. Mm-hmm. Vinyl's coming back.
Definitely.
Yeah. I mean, we have friends that we play with who put out their albums on vinyl, so.
All of it, too. Like, I mean, jazz, hip-hop,
awesome,
rock, like,
yeah.
Really, everything.
So are you working on an album now? Like, what is the
we're
stats?
We're writing for an album.
Okay.
Yeah.
How much you have completed so far?
None of your business.
Yeah.
Well, fine.
We've played like 3-hour shows with this band. I mean,
yeah.
Like, this band can play forever, but it's more of just picking them out and doing something,
okay.
You know.
Yeah, and we still have a good amount of songs on our repertoire.
Well, is it hard to like take the jam session and break it down into like something that could be an individual song?
It's impossible. I always say that the studio and live is just two different things.
Yeah,
and you just
completely
can't
different.
Do it's. I would love to be able to do the same thing, you know.
Yeah.
But I mean, we were talking about that the other day, how like Miles Davis would just, you know, like a lot of that, like from the famous album was like people's first takes on it, you know, like he would just give them music and first or second take, and then boom, it's one of the most famous jazz albums of all time. So it's like, it'd be great to do that, or we could go in with like a really structured, you know, like locked in job, you know. Yeah,
a little bit of both. We gotta find some balance.
Mm-hmm.
So have you guys put social media and stuff to your advantage so far, like with
Joe loves Facebook.
I am. I'm a communicator. I like talking to people.
Yeah.
I fought it for a long time, the whole chat. But
Dang, it's cool now.
I mean, I know, like they say, like Twitter and stuff can be a little bit scary.
So much, but I really like Facebook. I meet wonderful people on Facebook. I have a wonderful Facebook family. I love it.
The band doesn't do a Twitter account. I have one for like the website I run, and I think it could work for a band that's like very, very active. Like definitely, I could see it working when we're in the studio. You know, I could see it working like when we're on the road, things like that. But
yeah, it's like if you have a fan base that is constantly checking into what you're doing, you know, like Radiohead when they were about to release their new album, like every now and then you get like an update or something like that, and everybody would be like, oh, an update, you know? So, but I mean, like for a band that's like sort of, you know, working still, I mean, it's like, yeah, we could, but I mean, it's more just to like tell people when our shows are, and that's why we're not like updating them with like these, you know, really important things that are, you know, not yet,
That's great. Well, you know, I guess to kind of wrap things up with you guys, and, you know, what are some of the goals for the rest of this year? I know you mentioned some time on Warped Tour. Will you be at the Camden date?
It looks like we may be at the Camden date. Definitely the Long Branch, New Jersey date.
What we're doing on Warped Tour, Joe has a long-standing friendship with all the guys in Fishbone, and Angelo Moore from Fishbone, he has, you know, his solo project and personality, Dr. Mad Vibe, and so what we're doing on the Warped Tour is playing some Dr. Mad Vibe shows with him, but
where we're going to be able to mix in, like, what we do with sort of Angelo is like Angelo and Joe is like
called the Dr. Mad Vibe Late Bloomer Experience.
So it'll be a combination of a lot of things. So it should be really cool. Yeah. So that'll be in July, and then for the rest of the year, I mean, we're just gonna keep playing shows. I mean, that's all you can really do. And
try to tap into the festival circuit, you know, and everything. The whole thing is changing now. The festivals are taking off. The clubs aren't so much where it's at anymore. You know what I mean?
Well, so you're seeing.
You got to do a shift.
Well, you see such an eclectic mix of artists at these festivals. It's, and it's not, it's not one particular genre. You got metal bands next to rap artists next to jam bands.
That's what we do. I mean, we've been throwing a festival for, since fifth year now. We've been having it twice a year since 07. So we're doing Res Ball 9 in June. And we've got, I mean, I'm trying to think. We have this like sort of electro rock kind of band. We've got, I mean, me and Dave's other projects are playing, which are like a little, what would you say, heavy bluesy rock?
Yeah, it's like a Black Keys, White Stripes sort of deal, and this is like
it's kind of funky, riffy kind of
Black
stuff.
Keys,
yeah. We've got, I mean, and then we have like
everything. It's all over.
We have like an R&B, soul sounding, hip hop stuff. Like, I mean, it's and then
we can call us that, Black Keys, White Stripes.
There you go.
So if we wanted like a central location to kind of figure out what's going on with you guys online and stuff, where would we go for like the information?
I would say the Facebook. It's facebook.com/thelatebloomerband. Okay. That's we use that the most frequently, update that the most for sure.
Get some music on there and all that stuff.
Yeah.
And if we're ever playing a show, obviously, we'll come out.
Great.
We'd like to do another number for you.
That'd be great.
Yeah.
By all means.
Cool. Yeah, this is we'll do like a Gil Scott Heron tune.
Okay.
Called Lady Day John Coltrane.
Cool.
Alright. We refer to this song as the That's My Jam song.
Okay.
Sometime you might be riding down the road and you had a rough day. You know what I mean? People done got on your nerves. And flicking around on your radio station. commercials on everywhere. Stuff like that.
Thank you.
You just can't seem to find what you do. So you stop and you have a drink, you know. Or you pull over and you roll one up, you know, whatever. Get right. I'm still missing something. And you turn that radio station a little bit more. Hot damn! Say it to yourself, you say, that's my jam right there. Ooh, that's my jam.
This song is written by Gil Scott Heron. One of my musical mentors, Gil Scott Heron, is the reason that I sing. This is the truth. The name of the song is Lady Day John Coltrane. People
that some people call on after having a rough day and they need to hear their jam.
Spirit up in there, believe me when I tell you.